I'd like, for the folks who just came in, I'd like to invite you to please grab something to eat. Buffet looks lovely. Bring it to your table and get settled so that we can start today's program. For those of you whom I don't know, my name is Steve Slick. I'm the director of the Intelligence Studies Project here at the university. We're very pleased that you could join us today for the first event of the Intelligence Studies Project spring programming. So I want to thank first our staff and teams from the Strauss and the Clements Center for supporting this event, and also for our friends and our hosts today at the LBJ Presidential Library. It's a great venue and an appropriate one for events like this. And while I have your attention, and while some folks are still grabbing something to eat, let me make a few programming announcements. Next Thursday, the Intelligence Studies Project will be hosting a lunchtime talk at Sid Richardson Hall, just across the courtyard here, by Mark Thiessen, who's a scholar with the American Enterprise Institute, a former speechwriter for Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld, as well as President George W. Bush. Okay? And Mark is also, for those of you who follow this sort of thing, the author of a very, frankly, provocative book, called Courting Disaster, which he wrote several years ago describing the CIA's rendition, detention, and interrogation program. So, and I know Mark's not just a provocative writer, but an entertaining speaker. So I would encourage you to come over to that. And then next month, on March 23rd, we're going to hold our annual intelligence symposium down at the Edgar Harbin Alumni Center. The title this year is Intelligence in Defense of the Homeland. And we're very pleased to say that our speakers for this symposium will include the FBI Director Jim Comey, as well as President Trump's new Homeland Security Advisor, Tom Bosser. Now, this event is open to the public and free, but it will require advanced registration, and I suspect this is going to be a hot ticket. So we're going to post this next week on the ISP site, and so you'll want to get in there if you're interested in attending, and please do register. So it's our pleasure today to present a book talk by David Priess, who's the author of a fascinating and unusually timely, I have to say, book entitled The President's Book of Secrets. So after David speaks, what we're going to do is we're going to have him be joined on stage by my colleague Paul Pope, who's going to moderate a discussion that will include, of course, as is our custom, all of your questions. I should probably take a minute and just note Paul's changed status here. In our community. Last summer, Paul finished up a really important two-year tenure at the LBJ School as CIA's officer in residence, and we were fortunate that he agreed to stay on in Austin in his new capacity as a clinical professor at the LBJ School and as a senior fellow in our Intelligence Studies Project. And Paul, of course, brings a wealth of experience in the Army, in CIA, and the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, which contributes every day to what we can offer our students. So, without any further ado, I'll say David Priess is a former CIA officer who served during the Clinton and Bush 43 presidencies, and is an analyst, analytic manager, and intelligence briefer. Holds a PhD in political science from Duke, and after leaving government, he set upon the project that brings him here today to research and write this important book called The President's Book of Secrets. And I should have mentioned a little bit earlier, this table over here to the left, signed copies, of David's book are available there for purchase if you'd like, directly adjacent to the Ivanka Trump jewelry. So I spent the weekend curled up, among other things, with David's book. I had to confess to him last night at dinner that it took me this long to read it, but it was really worth the wait. And so what David does in this book is provides an absolutely terrific account of the history of the U.S. intelligence community's support to U.S. presidents. David skillfully tells the story from the creation of the President's Intelligence Checklist, or PIGL, which was printed to fit in President Kennedy's shirt pocket, to the modern PDB, which President Obama used to receive every morning on an iPad. And so it's a terrific story. David's done a great job of researching and telling it. And now he's going to share with us today some of the main points that we can take away. So anyway, David, welcome.
Good afternoon. I will let you know if you don't hear this, otherwise I will just project as well as I can. This is the story about the President's Book of Secrets, which is a shorthand for the document known as the President's David Brief, or the PDB. You'll hear me using all of those terms interchangeably for the next few minutes. What I'm going to do is just give a quick overview for about half an hour or so of how this document has evolved over the past several decades, and then we'll open it up for a conversation and your questions, because frankly, that's more interesting than the general overview. I want to hear what you're interested in, especially how this might apply to what's going on today. The history of the President's Daily Brief really is a history of the intelligence policy relationship at its highest level. There are plenty of ways that intelligence gets to senior policy customers in the United States government. But the President's Daily Brief is the most exclusive of those. It's the only one that has its recipient named in the title, the President's Daily Brief. As such, it is intended to be written for the President, designed for the occupant of the Oval Office. It is daily, that is, it is produced every working day and has been for more than 50 years. And it is brief. The President of the United States has a schedule that is measured down to the minute. The President does not have time for superfluous material. Therefore, it has always been short. In some cases, you can go to the research room next door, try copies of the President's Daily Brief for Lyndon Johnson that were just one or two pages long. We have other presidents who have had it that have been dozens of pages long on any given day. According to the news reports this very morning, President now is getting it about 3 pages long. There's variety, but it depends on the style and preferences of each president. And I'll walk you through some of the stories of each of the presidents, some of the highlights that I got from researching this book. Now, where did I get the information for this book? This book is not a memoir. It's not me telling about my experiences as a PDB briefer. I talked to all the living former presidents and vice presidents, the former CIA directors, most of the former national security advisors, secretaries of state, secretaries of defense, White House chiefs of staff, and others who had access to this privileged document. So this is really the story of their stories, how they produced this document over the years, how they delivered the document, how they received the document and acted upon it. Now, the story really starts with this man, John F. Kennedy, seen here with his military assistant, General Ted Clifton. John Kennedy came into office with a decidedly different approach to intelligence and policymaking from his predecessor, General Eisenhower. Eisenhower liked a stately procession of planned meetings. Every week, planned out months in advance, they would have National Security Council meetings, where they would have long, extended conversations teed up in exactly the same way with an intelligence briefing on Italy. And then next week it was going to be on China. Then the following week it would be on Spain, and so on and so forth. Not this guy. That's not the way he did business. In fact, some of his advisors said that going to a meeting with John Kennedy on foreign policy was like a combination of a Harvard seminar and a touch football game, because it moved so quickly. He would bounce between topics, he would want ad hoc consultations to help him, and then he would move on quickly. The same thing applied to the way he read documents. They started out with Kennedy's term, with his military assistant, pictured here, giving him all of the documents that they used to put on Eisenhower's desk. And eventually, it was a stack pretty tall between you get through all the documents from the Defense Department, the CIA, the State Department, etc. But what happened? Kennedy wasn't reading them. He didn't want to read through all of these documents. So Clinton tried briefing, but he found that he could not get the president to sit still long enough to have an extended briefing. So they called in this man. This is Dick Layman, a senior CIA officer at the time and the father of current intelligence at the Central Intelligence Agency. They called him into the White House and said, here's what we need from you. We want you at CIA to pull together everything that the president needs to know and push aside everything he doesn't. And we want you to compile it from all of these documents sitting on his desk each morning. We'd like you to put it in a format that he can carry around with him because we can't get him to sit still. So can you produce it in a way that he can just fold it, put it in his pocket? Oh, can you get rid of all of that government gobbledygook? All of those annoying classification markings, like that parentheses with the C in it, that apparently is hard to decipher. What could it mean? And so they did it. In fact, they did it quickly, because this man had already anticipated the needs of the president. He had been spouting off to colleagues already in the early months of the Kennedy administration. We can't treat this president the way we treated the old one.
So he already had a template in his mind of what this new document was going to look like. So the very next morning, incredibly fast in the history of government bureaucracy, the very next morning they had a draft of the President's Intelligence Checklist, the tickle that Steve referred to. They had that ready for Ted Clifton to look at. He liked it, so the very next day they took the first copy to John F. Kennedy. This was the first copy. I'm sorry, this was the first product, the President's Intelligence Checklist. This one is actually from November 1963. But it is the President's Intelligence Checklist. You can see a small document. You could fold it, put it in his pocket. This is where John Kennedy got his first President's Intelligence Checklist. His leased country estate out in Middleburg, Virginia. He would swim laps often in the pool to relieve his aching back. Ted Clifton found him there on a Saturday morning, gave him the first copy of this document. True to form, Kennedy opened it up, read a piece or two, said he liked it, and then put it aside and kept swimming, and then went back to finish the rest of it later on. It worked. He was hooked. And you can find documentation talking about how he tasked people based on it. He would react to it immediately, putting out word to those who followed him, what do we need to do about this? Now, that was a bit of a problem, because at the beginning, this document was only going through the president, the national security advisor, and after it was going to the president, they also gave it to the director of central intelligence. But Kennedy was tasking people on it. He was calling up the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Defense, telling them what to do, and they were wondering, where are these issues coming from? So 6 months later, they added to the dissemination list Dean Rusk and Robert McNamara, the Secretaries of State and Defense. And that is a pattern that has generally continued to today. Generally, the President's Daily Brief has also gone to top officials. But there's someone who's left out. Statutorily, the National Security Council has the President, the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Defense, and the Vice President. So, Dick Layman again recognized that this product was going to everybody on the NSC formally except for the Vice President. And he went into the National Security Council Executive Secretary and said, what about the Vice President? Shouldn't he be getting it? And the answer was firm, under no circumstances. Kennedy and Johnson, well, the relationship was not warm and fuzzy, and they actually excluded the Vice President from this document, which was a problem in November of 1963, because one day, Vice President Johnson suddenly becomes President Johnson. The Director of Central Intelligence at the time used a little dash of deception on this. Knowing that Kennedy and Johnson were not close, he decided to bluff. He had his assistant call the new president's assistant and say, would the new president like his regular 8 a.m. intelligence briefing tomorrow morning? There was no such briefing. This document had been delivered to the White House, but the CIA wasn't delivering it to the president. That was done by Ted Clifton. But he was betting that Johnson wouldn't know that because he had been excluded from most policy. Okay, it worked. Johnson said absolutely. So the next morning, the director goes downtown, gets to see the President of the United States, but it's awkward because he's giving him the President's Intelligence Checklist, clearly not something they created the last few hours. And the director noted afterwards, he said it was clear when I gave it to him that he had not seen it before. Couldn't find out what that meant because both participants in that meeting are no longer with us. But it makes a lot of sense that Johnson didn't warm to the product. It wasn't his. It was clearly a holdover from John F. Kennedy, like so much else around him in the White House. So what did they do? After a while, trying out different things, trying to find ways to get him to enjoy it, they did what government bureaucracies also do, which is you reformat what you're already doing, you put a new title on it, and pretend it's something all new. So that's what they did for Lyndon Johnson. December 1964, they create the President's Daily Brief, a reformatted version of the President's Intelligence Checklist. Still meets the general characteristics of this document for Kennedy, tailored personally to the style and preferences of the president. For John F. Kennedy, it was written in journalistic style, folded so he could fit it into a pocket. All of that is because of John Kennedy, not just because of the president, but the particular president. Same thing with the PDB. Now it was a full-size document. If Lyndon Johnson didn't fold things, put them in his pocket, and run around, he tended to sit and read things. In fact, they adjusted the delivery of this product to Lyndon Johnson's unique quirks, one of which was his night reading. Lyndon Johnson did a lot of his work late at night, sitting in bed in his pajamas. He would have a stack next to him that his chief of staff would prepare, and he would go through sometimes feet of material, memos, documents, correspondence. And what they started doing is delivering the PDD in the afternoon, so it could be in his night reading stack. Made it a whole lot easier for the analysts writing for it, too. Because the CIA experts were pulling together all of this intelligence and trying to assess what it meant and condensing it down to one or two pages on each item, they didn't have to work overnight on this and deliver it in the morning. They could work on it in a regular work day and have it delivered late afternoon. Lyndon Johnson took to the PDD. There's plenty of documentation, and having spoke with two of his chiefs of staff who are still with us, they pointed out, yes, he was an avid reader. He did react to the document. He took action based on it. And in part, that's because of some of the intelligence successes that were there during the Johnson administration. The tale of the 1967 war. The fact is, the intelligence community predicted, as it started, that it would not last more than 10 days, probably closer to 7 days. Well, it ended up becoming known as the Six-Day War. So there were some successes, but there were also some things that didn't help Johnson that much. He did not appreciate analysis on Vietnam generally, because the analysis on Vietnam was generally not conducive to the policy working the way he thought it would. So there was some tension there. Some of that was deflected from the President's Daily Brief, because the CIA was producing a separate Vietnam supplement. So that gave him, in a sense, bad news. But the rest of the world, you can see these now, these are all declassified. You can see this was covering Soviet space issues, NATO dynamics, everything happening in Africa in the late 60s, Middle East conflict. All of that was well covered in the President's Daily Brief. How do we know Johnson read it? Take a look. He's reading it. This was a picture taken of the President's Daily Brief. You can see the President with Lady Bird and a grandchild who did not have a clearance. First security scandal of the President's Daily Brief's history. As far as we know, there was no leakage of information. Other leakage, perhaps. The proof that Lyndon Johnson read, and this appeared in the newspapers at the time. The first regular transition of the President's Daily Brief was to his successor, Richard Nixon, pictured here with Henry Kissinger. Now, that should have been a smooth transition. If there was ever a president-elect who was inclined to really enjoy the nuts and bolts of national security and intelligence, it should have been Richard Nixon. He'd been vice president for 8 years previously. He'd been a prominent senator on national security issues. He should have loved this document. But he hated the CIA. In particular, he hated the analytic wing of the CIA that produced the assessments appearing in the President's Daily Brief. So during the transition to Richard Nixon, the CIA set up a support hub in New York near his transition headquarters. And they had officers up there who went to brief Richard Nixon on the President's Daily Brief, because President Johnson, the sitting president, allowed his successor to see this most secret document containing classified information from all intelligence collection sources. He allowed him to see it as president-elect to prepare him for the job. They went to see Nixon. Nixon wouldn't see him. So they tried the next best thing. They put it into an envelope. They delivered it to Rosemary Woods, his secretary, gave her a safe so she could keep it, and said, please protect this document, but get it to the president-elect and read it at his leisure. They never heard any feedback. And in fact, at the end of the transition period, they got a stack back of all of these envelopes unopened. It appears that Richard Nixon didn't even bother to read it once during the transition. Now, we shouldn't fool ourselves. There was intelligence getting to the president, and it was through the other man pictured here. Henry Kissinger was reading the PDB too. Henry Kissinger was getting intelligence briefings. There's no doubt that he was communicating some of those messages to the president, but it was not the direct channel, right to the eyes of the president, that the intelligence community had gotten used to via the Johnson administration. Now, as the administration went on, you had some different people entering the picture. Here you see, right before he became vice president, is vice president nominee Gerald Ford, sitting next to Richard Nixon. The CIA decided to, well, let me put it this way. There's contradictory information about whether the CIA planned this or not. But I have a feeling they did, and I'll tell you why. Gerald Ford had been nominated as vice president. He was coming into office. After he became vice president, he came out for a tour of CIA headquarters. He's going through getting a series of briefings, having a series of meetings with senior agency officials. At one point, the director, walks him through what then was called the Office of Current Intelligence. This was the part of the analytic wing of CIA that produced the President's Daily Brief and other daily intelligence documents. As they're walking through, sitting on a table, just happened to be several current intelligence products, including the President's Daily Brief, which at the time was going only to Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger. And as they walk by, Vice President sees it, says, "What's that?" "Oh, well, Mr. Vice President, that's the President's Daily Brief. That's going every day to President Nixon and Dr. Kissinger. Would you like to see it?" "Why, sure." And immediately the director says, "Tell you what we'll do. Not only will we deliver the document to you, but we've got a senior analyst, Dave Peterson, who we think would be good to chat with you about it. How about we send him with the product so that he can brief it to you and he can answer questions you have and talk about some of the nuance behind the assessments, maybe some of the alternative assessments that don't make it into the printed document." And Ford said, "Sure. I mean, after all, he's vice president. There's not that much to do as vice president." This is before the days of the Naval Observatory. So the vice president was living in his house in Alexandria, Virginia. And every working day, Dave Peterson would go to Ford's house and brief him on the President's Daily Brief, either at his kitchen table or in the car ride downtown. Now what happens a few months later? The winds of Watergate are blowing, the vice president becomes president, and Gerald Ford decides he's going to continue this practice. And he becomes the first president to get a CIA officer briefing him on the President's Daily Brief every working day that he's in Washington. Now why do I think the CIA planned this? Well, because there is a memo in the Ford Library, maybe also in the Nixon Library, that shows that the day before Vice President Ford's visit, there were these planning documents about David Peterson, CIA officer, who we will propose to Ford, briefs him on the intelligence. So it sure seems to me like the director staged this. One CIA history I found, however, stated that it was an inadvertent disclosure of the President's Daily Brief to Ford. That's the funniest version of inadvertent I've ever seen. So Gerald Ford, in his office, reading the President's Daily Brief became a daily occasion. But he almost always also had Brent Scowcroft, the Deputy National Security Advisor, because Henry Kissinger, who was dual head as National Security Advisor and Secretary of State, usually started his day at the State Department. And then Dave Peterson, the CIA briefer. There was one other common participant at these briefings, someone else who regularly attended the PDB sessions between President Ford, CIA's Dave Peterson, and the National Security Advisor's deputy. And as far as I can tell in my research, it is the only person who routinely attended the President's Daily Brief sessions naked. Yeah, it's liberty. What were you? This is Liberty, the president's prized golden retriever. Liberty was a very, very enthusiastic dog. And Dave Peterson remembers the time that he was briefing the president, and Liberty was bouncing back and forth between Brent Scowcroft and the president, and so putting to get scratched behind the ears, wagging tail enthusiastically, a little too enthusiastically one day, because Liberty was wagging her tail so much that she nearly knocked over one of President Ford's prized pipe racks. And President Ford banished Liberty from PDB sessions. Yeah. It was a sad day for the canine national security community. The next president was, of course, Gerald Ford's successor, Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter did not take in-person daily briefings of the President's Daily Brief, but instead he chose to get it in writing and then do what you see here. Jimmy Carter processed information by writing. He often would write directly on memos what he wanted to be done with them. He would write questions. He processed and thought through things through his hands. Now, that's bad for the President's Daily Brief in that there was no longer a CIA person in the room talking to him about it, giving him that information, getting direct feedback. But it was really good for CIA officers preparing the President's Daily Brief because written in his hand was often the direct reaction to the analysis he was getting. And the National Security Advisor, Dr. Zbigniew Brzezinski, would pass those copies to the CIA or pass on those comments directly. So it was not a direct relationship, but it was a generally good relationship. One person who felt excluded, of course, was Stansfield Turner. Stansfield Turner was the president's eventual nominee to become director of Central Intelligence. But the process had already started. because he started, I believe, in March, and there have been 2 months of transition already. Well, what happened? The President's Daily Brief was included by Dr. Brzezinski in the President's Daily Morning Meeting that he himself was running. There was no CIA officer there. Well, Admiral Turner comes into office, looks at the President's schedule and sees intelligence briefing, and says, wait a minute, I'm the President's lead intelligence advisor. I should be the one delivering those briefings to him. So he goes to Dr. Brzezinski and says, you know what, I'm going to start coming. I'm going to start delivering the intelligence to the President every morning. Brzezinski, not a dumb guy, takes his pen, goes to the President's schedule, crosses out the word intelligence in intelligence briefing, and writes national security. And he says, it's not an intelligence briefing. It's a national security briefing. I'm the national security advisor. We'll just incorporate the PDB into that. So Stansfield Turner did not get in to see President Carter to brief the PDB every day. But he got the next best thing, which most senior members of the government did not get, which is regular access to the president. At least once a week, often twice a week, he would have extended sessions with the president. He would do things like take analysts and operators from the CIA in to meet the president to talk about the issues that were raised in the PDB. And he told me that many times his meetings with the president were based on things that appeared in the president's daily brief that the president had written, I want more information on this, thus allowing deeper dives on those very topics. After Jimmy Carter, Ronald Reagan comes into office. Ronald Reagan had a huge number of advisors early in his administration. A lot of turnover, a lot of turmoil. We would never see that again in America. You see some of them pictured here. The myth about Ronald Reagan is that Ronald Reagan was not a reader, certainly not of top secret intelligence documents. That doesn't fit the narrative. Well, we can debunk that myth, but for three reasons. One, he talked to the people who briefed him the most, and Ronald Reagan would read. In fact, his national security advisors, he had six of them. The pace that we're in with this administration may break that record, but he had six of them during the course of his administration, and his national security advisors all told me if they gave him a document to read, he would read it. And this actually became a problem, because sometimes they would give him reading for daytime or for the weekends at Camp David when he went there with Nancy. And the problem they had is they would put in a document that had a summary, and they would put a post-it note on it saying, please, just read the summary. We include the whole report, just in case you have a follow-on question, it might be answered within. They found if they gave him the report, he would read the whole thing. He thought it was his homework, and he used that term in his diaries quite a bit to say, I felt like I had to do my homework. One person really did not like this, and that's Nancy Reagan. She wanted her Ronnie at night, she wanted her Ronnie on the weekends. She did not like the fact that the staff was giving him so much to read, even though that was not their purpose. So that's one reason to know that he read. Secondly, if you look at his diaries, which have now been published, and you can find them in their entirety at the Reagan Library, if you look at the hundreds or thousands of pages, he would write entries every single day about what he did and what struck him each day. There's a significant number of entries that refer specifically to the President's Daily Brief or the PDB, or the daily intelligence briefing, things that show that he was paying quite a bit of attention to it. Third, I wasn't able to do this, but the historians at the CIA were able to. They could go into the vaults where the old copies of the president's daily brief are kept, the ones that the president read and were returned for safekeeping. Those have not been declassified yet. But one of the historians went into the vaults and looked at the first 1,000 copies of the president's daily brief, first 3 years of Reagan's administration, just to see every single page, what was going on there. And he found that on a significant minority, but on a significant number of pages, there were markings in Reagan's own hand. There were underlines, there were question marks, there were questions being asked. In some cases, Reagan was adding up numbers that were in the text of a piece in the president's daily brief that had not been summed up for him. In one case, he even caught a typo in the president's daily brief. That was a bad day for the editor the next day, I'm sure. So he probably read the document very carefully. The whole reason that he was reading it intently, though, probably has to do with the man he's sitting with here, George H.W. Bush. In fact, Ronald Reagan took briefings during his own transition before becoming president directly because of him. Because Bush's CIA briefer said to him, could you mention to the president that it might be useful for him to get in-person briefings during the transition? Bush mentioned it to Reagan. Reagan's staff gave a phone call to CIA as President-elect Reagan was flying from Washington to California and said, get a briefer out here for tomorrow morning in California. and they had to quickly get out to California to start briefing the president. During the Reagan administration, something happened with the president's daily brief that had not happened much before, which is the president's daily brief started to get disseminated more widely, informally, especially throughout the West Wing and the White House. Staffers were seeing it that were not supposed to be seeing it. And that really upset one person in particular, George H.W. Bush. He had been director of Central Intelligence. He knew the kinds of sources and methods that could be revealed in the president's daily brief if it got out. So he was quite upset about it. He told me it's one of his most vivid memories of the Reagan administration and intelligence, is how upset he was at the fact that this was floating around during the Reagan administration. Perhaps that's why when he became president, pictured here, he changed the method for the president's daily brief to get to the president. Instead of getting it as a written document, having it passed around the West Wing, he instituted a rule. He said, everybody who gets the president's daily brief, including the president, is going to have a CIA briefer deliver it to him. And you're going to read it in the presence of that briefer, or you can have a chat with the briefer about it. In this case, you see in the back of the room, Chuck Peters, the CIA briefer who saw the president most often during his four-year term, as well as some senior national security officials of his administration. Yeah. And what you see here is the PDB briefing happening. What happened when the briefing was done? The president talks to the briefer for 10, 15, 20 minutes. They talk about the intelligence. Briefer leaves the rooms with the copies of the president's daily brief. The president could keep a copy if he wanted to, and occasionally he did, but most of the time he didn't. And he insisted, the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Defense, his Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, his National Security Advisor, follow the same practice. You return the PDB. That allowed the most sensitive sources and methods to be included in it. There was no chance of that book floating around during his administration. President Bush took the PDB so seriously that he didn't have to take it seriously. I'm going to have to explain that. He took it so seriously that he would have in-depth conversations with his briefers. He would shoot policy ideas around. He would use it as a way of talking about national security on a daily basis. But he also knew that some of the issues in there weren't so serious that he couldn't have a little fun with it. So very beginning of his term, he told his briefer, Chuck Peters, he said, you're going to have to tell the Office of Comic Relief to step up its efforts. And of course, the DCI, Judge Webster, who's sitting there next to him in this picture, looked over at him like, where's the org chart? What's the Office of Comic Relief? Quickly found out it was just the Vice President's way of saying, you know what, let's lighten up the text a little bit. Reagan got it very straightforward. I'd like to have a little bit of humor in here. One example from a PDB editor at the time, he told me that there was a piece about the movement of Soviet armor out of what was then East Germany, and it was going back towards the Soviet Union. And they titled the piece, Tanks for the Memories. That's the kind of thing you can get away with George H.W. Bush. Following George Bush, of course, was Bill Clinton, pictured here with Vice President Al Gore, and with one of his intelligence briefers when they finally did get in to see him, a man you might recognize. Looks a little different now. That's John Brennan, most recently CIA director. 20 years earlier, he was one of Bill Clinton's daily intelligence briefers. Bill Clinton had a real ebb and flow with the president's daily brief. He tried to schedule daily briefings, but Clinton was more like Kennedy in several ways, perhaps. In terms of the way he took intelligence, he was like Kennedy, in that he could not sit still long for briefings. Or, sometimes the opposite. He sat still too long for briefings. Once he got engaged on a topic, he did not let go. He wanted to talk through it, ad nauseum. So a 10 o'clock meeting that was scheduled to go for an hour would go until 10:30. Then the 10 o'clock meeting wouldn't start until late, and that would go until noon. Well, the court PDB briefer who was scheduled to come in at 10:30 sometimes never got into the Oval Office. So over time, the briefings stopped and became irregular. But he continued to read it very carefully. In fact, he told me that he loved the president's daily brief because it was a chance for him to spur things, to get people to think about things, because he had the opportunity to see the best intelligence information out there and then use that to drive government operations. He also used it in his telling of the story to help prevent a nuclear war. India and Pakistan were going at it again, as they periodically do, and the Prime Minister of Pakistan came to Washington to try to get Bill Clinton to intercede and basically give him a face-saving way out of this conflict that he had started. An article in the President's Daily Brief told Bill Clinton that morning that he was meeting with the Pakistani Prime Minister that the Pakistanis and Indians did not have a complete picture of each other's intentions and capabilities. maybe even of their own intentions and capabilities, because of the lack of civil-military relations on the scope that we are used to. He actually used the information in that president's daily brief with the Pakistani prime minister to scare him about the magnitude of this crisis. Do you realize you are on the brink of nuclear Armageddon? Because India and Pakistan both had nuclear weapons, and they were in the shooting war. And he said it helped him get the Pakistani prime minister to walk back from the brink of Armageddon. That's impact. That's the president's daily reporting, even if there was not a daily in-person briefing. Now, of course, the president after Clinton is George W. Bush. This is a picture that you may have seen before. This is from the morning of September 11th, 2001. President Bush was in Florida, part of his education agenda. He spoke to a group of school children as planes started flying into buildings. This is the command room that they had set up in the classroom next door. National Security Council and White House Communications Agency always set up a command room. This is the president talking to the vice president. What you see on the left is someone that most people seeing the photograph say, oh, that's the guy with the football. You know, that's the nuclear codes. Because look at him standing at attention. Look at him holding the briefcase. Why else would somebody be there? That's Michael Morrell. That was his daily PDD briefer. Because George W. Bush took things up a notch from his father. He not only took a daily intelligence briefing from a CIA briefer while in Washington, he started taking the briefers with him on both domestic and international travel. So Michael Morrell was with the president, flying around in Air Force One that historic day, helping be a conduit back to CIA headquarters to let the president know what was going on after the 9/11 attacks. President Bush took it up another notch from his father as well. In addition to just having a briefer every day, either in the United States or abroad, he also instituted formally what became known as the deep dives, where in his second term, he not only took daily in-person intelligence briefings on the president's daily brief from his intelligence services, he also started adding at least a couple of times a week in-depth sessions with individual experts from the intelligence community. Bring in the person who's been studying Iran for 20 years. I'm going to sit and have a 30-minute conversation with them about the intricacies of Iranian relationships. Bring in the expert on the Iraqi military, because I want to know what's going on there. In his first 18 months of doing it, he had had more than 200 analysts from the intelligence community come in and talk with the president in depth about issues. That's the kind of relationship he had with his book of secrets. The most recent president to complete his term, Barack Obama, pictured here with his president's daily brief. Looks a little bit different than Lyndon Johnson. First of all, he's not in a robe. Secondly, he has no grandchildren. But, of course, you also notice the medium of delivery has changed. The president's daily brief for President Obama became electrons on a screen instead of ink on paper. He got his PDB on an iPad. Now, the analysis is still the analysis. It's still experts from across the intel community trying to get their best judgment of what's going on around the world to the President of the United States. But this gave them a little more flexibility. They could do things like interactive displays. They could do things where the president could change variables and the analysis would then show the impact. They could have videos playing instead of having to bring in a separate video projector for the president. So it's just a different method of delivery, but it's something that shows the president's daily brief is targeted to the style and preferences of the president. In this case, it worked for him. We do not have a picture yet of the current president reading his president's daily brief. By the accounts we've seen, he does read the president's daily brief. He does get briefings. But the reports that are out indicate that the style has changed. He said he's a man who does not want long documents. He said he likes bullets more than long pieces of paper. So it would be folly for the intelligence community not to be giving him a document that has bullets and is not long. That is adjusting to the style and preferences of the president. The story of all of these, and a lot of other stories, are in the book. I'm not going to go into every story because I want to hear what you're interested in. We're going to start that off with a conversation up here, and then we'll be happy to take your questions. Thank you. Thank you, David, for that, and thanks for being here. I have a few questions I'm going to ask to get us going, and then we'll turn it over to the audience. But you know, one of the I was thinking when I read your book about Sherman Kent, who you mentioned the father of current intelligence, Lane, and he was the father of estimative intelligence.
And he talked about how the marriage between the decision maker and the intelligence officers who are trying to help him should be one made in heaven, but it's not. And the way I read your book was the story, and you were actually finishing on President Trump, the story of trying to tailor to the needs of that particular individual. One of the things that's happened lately, I wanted to start with this, is in the early days of your story, how even the existence of the PDB might not have been widely known, but if it was, it wasn't widely talked about. Now, it's a matter of political fire to talk about what kind of briefing, how much briefing, when's the briefing. What do you think about that? What's the implications of that being such a hot topic?
Yeah, it's surprising. When I talked with some of the officers who worked on the President's Daily Brief back in the 60s and the 70s, they told me stories. They were told not to mention the existence of the President's Daily Brief. This private channel to the President was considered so sacred that they were told, even to other members of the intelligence community, as CIA officers, they should not talk about the President's Daily Brief, which led to a really awkward conversation. You're in a classified space talking with people with full security clearances, and you're working on a joint intelligence product that's destined for people just below that level. And they asked from perhaps the Defense Intelligence Agency, so is this going to turn into a PDB? And the officer says, I'm sorry, what are you talking about? Some people remember being told that the words President's Daily Brief, when put together, were classified. And it's a bit funny, because you saw the picture of Lyndon Johnson with the President's Daily Brief that was in a newspaper. You had Henry Kissinger giving interviews in the 70s talking about the President's Daily Brief. You had Jimmy Carter in his memoirs citing the President's Daily Brief and describing what it was and who it went to. So the fact that it was the worst kept classified secret that there was, if that's true. So I went to the person that most people pointed to. People said, well, it was only classified until around 1990. Because when Bob Gates became director, Bob Gates declassified the existence of the PDB at the same time he declassified the existence of the National Reconnaissance Office. So I asked him. I said, everybody's saying you declassified the existence of the PDB. Do you remember that? And he just laughed. He said, no, it was always unclassified. Why do people think I did that? One of those funny things about Washington. That said, it was still not something that was in the headlines very often. And in fact, it only became a topic of public conversation after 9/11, when the 9/11 Commission was allowed to look at the President's Daily Briefs as part of their investigation. First time in history this had been allowed to happen. If you look at the full 9/11 report, you will see the text of two separate PDB articles are published. One from the Clinton administration, 1998, warning of aircraft hijackings by Al-Qaeda, and one from August 2001, which talked about bin Laden's intent to attack in the United States. It also mentioned the hijacking, but that information was not related to 9/11. That got interest going in the President's Daily Brief. But even then, that was considered an aberration. George Tenet, as director, and the White House said, we are only allowing the commission to do it because of these extraordinary circumstances. This is not precedent-setting. Well, let's fast forward a few years. What's happened in the last few years? All of the daily intelligence documents, including the PDB, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon, and Gerald Ford, are declassified. Nothing in a democracy stays secret forever. Now, headlines talk about the President's Daily Brief. This last year, during the election campaign, when transition intelligence briefings were going to Secretary Clinton and to Mr. Trump, that was the topic of political talk shows. During the transition, whether Trump was getting the briefing or not was above the fold in newspapers. This is the kind of thing that was unheard of decades ago. Now, the President's Daily Brief is a topic for conversation. What's not a topic for conversation, legitimately, is the content of that document. That is a privileged channel between the President and his intelligence community, however he chooses to use it. The fact that he gets it, the fact that he's getting briefed or not, that's inherently unclassified. That's a scheduling issue. What's in it? What secrets does it have? That's the kind of thing that should not be in the public sphere.
Thank you. You mentioned that roughly about 15 years of PDBs have been released. And I wanted to ask you a few questions. I'm sure we have historians in the audience. And so I'll ask about three about the same topic, which is how long should we expect to wait for these releases? Is there any chance of that being shortened? Who decides? And one more question, does every PDB get in there or only some?
Yeah, the PDBs have been largely declassified. Some are still held back or redacted. You may have seen that in old documents where they have the black bars or the whiteout to show that this is still sensitive. And there are good reasons for that. In some countries around the world, you've still got some of the same people in and around power that were there 40 years ago. And you don't want to reveal their association with intelligence, or perhaps even what intelligence was saying about them if they're still pulling the strings overseas. If there is an intelligence collection method that is explicitly referred to in the President's Daily Brief that is still being used today, you don't want that being exposed either. You want to protect the ability of the intelligence community to protect national security today and not reveal what was in the past. So you'll find, I think it's roughly around 20% of those documents have some level of redaction in them. So that's a possibility. Will this process continue? That is up to, ultimately, the President of the United States. If the President decides, I don't want to declassify any of these, they won't be declassified. There's no law saying the President's Daily Brief itself has to be declassified. However, the momentum has built. Now you've got successive administrations, Johnson, Kennedy, Nixon, Ford, of two different parties who have had their President's Daily Briefs rolled out. It would be surprising if that were rolled back, but it is within the purview of the President to do that.
Great. And we were actually talking about this earlier, that we have, in the next, in the current situation, we have a living president. So the timing is... I want to ask one more question, and it's about the briefer, you know, the role of the briefer. What are the qualities that make a good briefer? And, you know, is it something that, is it talent, is it process, is it human relationship, what is it?
It's mostly a shaved head, a goatee, knowing smart people. Briefer, I was surprised by this. When I was selected as a PDB briefer, my customer was not the president. I briefed some of the people that the president also designated to receive the PDB during the George W. Bush administration, the attorney general, the FBI director, and also occasionally the national security advisor and her deputy. I thought I would be selected as a briefer because I was a good briefer. That is because I could communicate effectively in that format. I'm sure that's a part of it, but clearly that's not the only measure. Instead, they said that they selected for judgment. And that makes sense if you think about it, because you have the entire work of the intelligence community on some issues at some level. You have the entire work of the intelligence community, collection, analysis, feeding into perhaps 2 minutes with the president or with other senior national security officials. And if this is a person who takes a briefing, and the briefer is going to effectively communicate that message or supplement the written word, that's a lot of power. And I've heard that with great power comes great responsibility. somebody said that. I think a superhero. So what they like to do is select people who aren't going to use that to make themselves look good, who aren't going to try to influence policy because they have that face time with some of the most powerful people in the national security bureaucracy. Instead, they want somebody who knows what the limits of the job are, to effectively communicate this information, to ensure that it is not misunderstood. Because some of these analyses are so nuanced about exactly what's going on in Syria, about exactly what they're likely to do if this happens. You can't have that be misunderstood. So I think the briefing selection has a lot to do with, is somebody going to abuse that position of access, or is somebody going to make sure that the information is expressed as clearly as possible?
Interesting answer, thank you. Okay, so let me open it to questions, and I'm going to go to Ed and Lyndon because I'm not dumb.
And I can't pull out of memory of Ed and Lyndon's microphone. I can't pull out of memory the. But my sense was in the early publications, tell the president what we knew, but rarely how we knew. And then there comes a point somewhere in there when actual how we knew it began to be included. And it was the only document published. When did that actually begin?
It was a slow process with some fits and starts. If you look at similar documents even back to the 1960s, you're right, largely it will be something that is today, by today's standards, very much just an assertion. And it doesn't have a lot of the backstory. But you will find cases where the sourcing is built in, where it will explain where some of the information came from. Those are the exceptions. Much more often were assessments, sometimes as short as a sentence or two, saying something like, President Nasser of Egypt is proposing a political reform program. We doubt it will amount to much. That was it. That was the analysis. What you see much more often now is more detailed explanation. This is what we know, this is what we don't know, this is our conclusion, these are alternative assessments. That's a much more common format now. To do that, you have to include some of the sourcing. You have to talk about the quality and the reliability of the information that underlies the assessment to help the decision maker understand how serious should I take this. That has been an evolution over time, but there was no one inflection point where suddenly all of that went in.
That's what worried me about declassification.
Yeah.
Not what you do, but telling how you do it.
Yeah, and some of that you will see in the, especially the Nixon and Ford ones, because it had started to creep in a little bit more in those. In fact, Nixon for a while had his PDD expressed where it was explicitly differentiated between fact and opinion. That is, some elements of the articles are what is known from various sources. So you have to tell what some of those sources are. And then there was the analyst's opinion. What do we make of all of those sources? As it goes on, it becomes even more interwoven into the document. So it may be hard to do. However, the names of individual sources, that is, what is the name of the person who's giving us this information from the Chinese foreign minister? That is almost never included in the PDB. That's something the briefer might tell the president if the president really wants to know. But generally, even the president doesn't want to know. The president wants to know, how confident are you in this sourcing? How confident are you in your assessment? They don't need to know the name of the person giving us that information.
They don't want to.
Yeah, protects them as well. Thank you.
Question.
Today.
Microphone.
So today we see in the news about there's a lot of fear that the intelligence community is holding back certain information from the current administration. And obviously, how much of that is just political fear, you know, and how much of that is reality, and how does it impact people's jobs?
I can't speak to what's happening right now. There are very few people who truly have access to that. There's a whole lot more people who appear to be talking. So you weigh how good that journalism is when there's consistent unnamed sources being quoted. I will say this, and this sounds like a shocking statement, but it's absolutely true. The intelligence community has always withheld information from the president. That's definitional. There are volumes, libraries full of intelligence collection every day. They're not telling the president all of that. The president doesn't need or want to know all of that. The president is getting that one-page assessment. By definition, you are withholding information from the president. Now that sounds nefarious, withholding it from the president. I'm not sure, based on the articles I've seen, that that's not the basis for it, which is, if this president is getting shorter assessments in bullet form rather than long narrative form, then of course more is being withheld. You're not going into the level of detail and nuance that you would with another president. If that's the way that it's being withheld, good. That's called customer service. If it's being withheld because the intelligence community doesn't trust the president with sensitive information, there's a deeper problem there. And that would be a problem for the intelligence community itself. It is the job of the intelligence community to inform the president. It's not the job of the intelligence community to decide who the president is or if the president is suitable for the job. That's the job of the American people. And the American people, through our constitutional system, have decided that. I have my suspicions about the sourcing of pieces like that, to know whether, in fact, that's happening. Part of it fits into a larger issue we won't get into detail here on, but the psychological construct that all of us have, confirmation bias. You get information and you fit it into your preconceived notions. You see what you expect to see. There may very well be journalists who want to see the story, maybe even they don't know it, but they expect to see the story of people withholding from this president because of the contentious relationship in the public sphere. And so when they get somebody saying, you know, the president is having information withheld from him, they immediately race from withheld to withheld for intent. I'm not sure we can go there based on what we know.
I'm going to ask a follow-up. Can you imagine a senior intelligence officer who would countenance withholding information from the president that he needed or wanted?
No. But two questions there. Could you imagine somebody withholding information from a president or another senior customer that he needed? No. I've never seen that, and the people that I know would not own up to that. The different question is that he wanted. Well, maybe. I would say for the president, you probably give him what he wants. But that can easily blend over into telling him what he wants to hear. And that is a cardinal sin of intelligence analysis. The job of analysis is to try to describe truth as best we see it, to try to illuminate what is going on in ways that can't be seen otherwise. It is not to tell the president what he wants to hear. If the president wants to hear that things are going great in Syria, and the intelligence community says that because they want the president to like them, that violates the ethics of intelligence. So I won't go as far on the want issue. On the need, if the president needs to know something, the intelligence community is going to give it to him. I don't care who's in the Oval Office.
I had this image in my mind of a couple of guys in a sedan driving from Langley into downtown every morning in rush hour traffic with the briefing book. And I'm wondering, I'm sure that there are people in the world who would love to know what is on the president's mind, what notes he's sending back, and that sort of thing. Do you know if anyone's ever tried to steal it, or hijack it, or hack the electronic version?
Next question. No, you might think that there are things like armored sedans and security and, you know, very sensitive routes. No, jet packs just flew across the river to do that. Let me put it this way. Without revealing anything sensitive that would jeopardize the president's daily brief, I never felt more secure in my career than when I was transporting the president's daily brief. I did not think there was much of a risk of it being compromised between where I had it inside the safety of Langley and when I was briefing it to my customers. I felt very confident about that. In terms of it being stolen, some of the funny stories in the book that came up is when the president's daily brief goes on the road. Because when you have the institutions in Washington and the mechanisms for secure delivery, that goes pretty well. But what happens when you have a Secretary of State who's traveling overseas and needs to see the president's daily brief? Well, there are some very good, sensitive communications channels to make that happen, but they're often on the move. And what happens when Secretary of State or the Vice President says, you know what, I've got to get to the airport to make my flight to this capital. Brief me in the car on the way. Okay, then you've got to use your judgment. Is that a secure place in which to hold the briefing? What happens, which did happen to one of the officers at the capital of Europe, when the principal said, brief me on the way to the plane. I'm flying to Moscow. I'll take the briefing and I'll take the book with me if we don't get finished. And the officer had to say, I'm going to put my foot down there. And I'm going to say, no. I will brief you in the car. I know you're going to be driving at 100 miles an hour, racing around and everything, but I'll brief it as best I can under those circumstances, but there's no way I'm letting you fly with this outside of that secure control. Now, all of these people travel with security. All of these people travel with secure mechanisms. But the president's daily brief is usually given one step above that. I could not find a documented case of the president's daily brief document itself being stolen or compromised or gone. But two stories that did come up that were interesting to me. One is that the information that's contained in it could be. That is, in the days back when the president's daily brief was passed among staffers in the West Wing, it very well could be that somebody had it on their desk, confused it with some other information, and said it to somebody who should not have received it. That's one. The other one was the story of perfect. Several people told me this, that there was a senior official in the Reagan administration who didn't have time during the day to read the copy that he made of the PDB that was floating around the West Wing. So he took them home with him and stored them in his garage. The National Security Advisor found out about that and quickly had the situation resolved securely. So not the same as it being stolen or compromised. In that case, there was no indication that any information was revealed, but certainly shows that that's something people have to pay attention to. Thank you.
Go to the student over here.
So I was curious, you brought up how Obama's briefings were always digital. Is there any challenge for the CIA to archive those, or they can use a new method, or is that like something that's known?
Yeah, and I should correct that. They were not always digital. He received paper at first and then shifted to the electronic. You saw the iPad there in the picture? I gave it to you. It was different than the iPad you have. All the connectivity and all of the wonderful things that you get an iPad for, very different there. I was told it was a very, very special iPad. I have no doubt that both the people producing the President's Daily Brief, who are very security conscious, and the White House staff around the President, I have no doubt that both of them took every step possible to ensure that this would not in any way jeopardize the material within the President's Daily Brief. Now, it does raise an issue, though, which is a book, when you can have Jimmy Carter or Ronald Reagan reading it and writing in the margins, you know what's been seen. You can see if something's been underlined. When I was a briefer, I had old-fashioned paper. I could see the pages being turned, and I knew when the customer I was briefing was turning to the next piece in the book. With the iPad, you can't see that. You don't know what's been looked at and for how long. Yes, there are probably electronic ways of tracking that. There's no way the White House legal office is going to allow the President's iPad to be tracked for things like that. So it does eliminate that possibility as a briefer to get some insight into what's going to be useful to the customer. But I have no doubt that it's secure. But if you're...
Well, I'm just curious, because you've talked about how historians have gone into archives,
right.
Looked at old papers and briefings.
Yeah.
Does the CIA like keep a bunch of digital records securely somewhere that they lose every time?
There is nothing that goes to the White House in any format that is not recorded. There are off-the-record discussions that can happen, what exactly the words that are said in a meeting that is off the book up in the residence might not be recorded verbatim, but I have no doubt that those documents are preserved, and maybe we'll see light of day in roughly 40 years.
Let me ask a follow-up question again. The iPad is, okay, it's a little different, but it presents the opportunity to use technology in different ways. Is it a good idea, or is it a big distraction to include multimedia, video?
It depends on the personality of the president. If I am a person who's going to be distracted by videos and transitions and animation, probably a bad idea for me to get intelligence in that format. If I'm somebody who's going to take more away from it, I'm a visual learner, and if I'm going to see the graph move and that's going to tell me the scope or magnitude of something better than words would, then it's more effective. I keep coming back to the fact that it's called the President's Daily Brief for a reason. It ain't targeted to what the Secretary of State needs. It's targeted to the President as the person of the President.
Other students behind this.
So we talked about the qualities that make a good briefer, but in your conversations with former presidents, what are the qualities that make a good briefing and have those changed over time?
Yeah, both from my experiences and from the experiences of the dozens of briefers that I talked to over the decades, what you want ideally is a customer, minimally, who takes this information seriously. I had the pleasure of having that, and the vast majority of briefers have had that. Regardless of what you think about partisan politics, you should be pleased to know that the senior national security officials of every previous administration took their job damn seriously. What they did with it in terms of policy, oh, let's debate that. That's our national pastime, right? But in terms of how they take the intelligence to inform them, I did not talk to a single person from the policymaking side or from the briefing side who didn't seem to take that process seriously. So that's number one. Number two, a good briefing is often misunderstood as when the intelligence briefer convinces the policymaker that the analysis is correct, that this assessment, which often is based on a whole number of unknowns and has no certain answer, but that the assessment that the experts have come to is correct. And that's a real misunderstanding. It was not my job as a briefer to convince somebody that this analysis was right. It was my job to make sure that they understood the analysis and how the conclusions were arrived at, that they understood the confidence level of those assessments. To the extent that the intelligence community has not done that in the past, things don't end well. This was the main conclusion in the investigation of the road to the Iraq War, was that a lot of the assessments in the President's Daily Brief did not have that level of confidence attached to them. Saddam Hussein has nuclear weapons, biological weapons, chemical weapons, program to develop those. some of the nuance of how credible the sources were and some of the nuance of how confident the analysts were in those judgments was lost in the president's daily brief. Nobody learns lessons better than the intelligence community. The amount of self-study, reflection, and self-flagellation that goes on after a perceived intelligence failure is massive. So I have no doubt that the intelligence being produced now is taking advantage of those lessons. So a good briefing does communicate those things. Communicates what is known, what is not known, what the conclusion is, how confident you are in each of those steps. Finally, I think a good briefing, ideally, is not a one-way street. It's not me briefing the policy customer. Here is the assessment. Thank you for listening. Goodbye. It's, here's the assessment. What's your reaction? What works for you? What doesn't? Not so we can tell you what you want to hear, but so we get insight into your policy process, and we know what intelligence would help you make better decisions. And if there's something in our logic or argumentation or sourcing that is not enough for you to make a decision, we need to know that, because then that helps us in the whole intelligence cycle ramp up the collection in the area that you need, or expand on the logic and argumentation in a way that perhaps other previous customers did not want. So that's an ideal briefing for me. When all those things are true, it's the best job in the world. When those things aren't true, it's one of the worst jobs in the world, because the implications are so severe.
Gentleman right here.
Yes, how concerned are you about the way the situation was handled the other night at the Florida President's Dinner, when the North Koreans launched their missile, and all of that thing happened right in front of 100 people, and telephones were going, iPads were going, and someone picked up a camera and then videotaped it? Mm-hmm. Isn't that a reason to be pretty concerned, or is that just something that we need to sort of say that it's in the learning phase of the president?
Yeah, I'm constitutionally wired to try to see the both sides of every issue, and on this one I clearly do. Because one thing that I haven't seen in any of the reports is that the papers that were floating around or the conversations were classified. Now, sensitive because it's the president's deliberations, of course. But the president, every president, picks up the phone and calls foreign leaders all the time discussing current events. If that is inherently classified and illegal, the president couldn't do that. Because I guarantee you, president of 197 countries in the world don't have U.S. security clearances. So at one level, if it's a discussion of an ongoing event, and it does not contain actual classified material, there's no story here. It's different. We haven't seen this before. Dinner out in a restaurant with guests and waiters around, and they're discussing a sensitive issue. Not necessarily an issue involving classified information and exposure. And that's where a lot of people race to. So that's one side of it. On the other side of it, I think it is a legitimate issue for the American people ultimately to decide is, do you want a president who treats sensitive national security conversations that cavalier? Or should you move to a secure environment, which is always close to the president? There's always the ability to have a sensitive classified discussion within seconds when you have a president, even if he's in the middle of a dinner in a public place. They will get him somewhere very close that is already protected, that has the ability to have that sensitive conversation. But that is a separate issue from whether it was actually classified material or not, which I have not seen in the discussion of this. The rush to judgment was just on the impropriety, which is a legitimate topic. Whether it was revealing classified information or not, we don't know, and probably won't know. Myself, I'm not an expert on cell phone technology. I've heard a lot of people out there saying, well, if you're putting a cell phone near it, those devices are easily hacked and you could see that document. Okay, if the document that was being presented to him, if I understand the timeline right, if the document that was being presented to him was, North Korean media is reporting this launch. Here's the video that they showed. Okay, that's already out there. I don't see a sensitivity to the phones being held up. If it was a bunch of people holding up actual personal cell phones that had not been provided with security measures on top secret documents, then there's a legitimate issue. I've not seen that followed up on.
In the back. So I have a question, more of a meta question. I was at the Eisenhower Library a few months ago, and you mentioned that Hayden used to have a daily briefing. In fact, his style of, arriving at consensus and getting the bureaucracy to move in the direction he wanted to move was to all these almost collegial meetings, the Solarium Project, and which was like the literally the Solarium of the White House, where they would meet on a weekly basis, things like that. And there was a particular quote of his, which I photographed, which ran that the United States never lost a soldier or put a ground in my administration. We get the peace. People ask how it happened. By God, it didn't just happen. I'll tell you that. So my question is, does the whole kind of, you know, basically by the minute, you know, news cycle and, you know, even almost kind of a propensity for micromanagement that, being on top of the situation all the time, does that encourage that? Is that necessarily a good thing? And maybe it's become so ingrained in the, you know, culture, bureaucratic culture, that maybe, you know, it might be a good idea to step back and look at it, the bigger picture, I mean. So just your thoughts on that.
Yeah, let me put it in a wider context. There is a procedure that has developed over time for national security decision making. The procedure, generally, for the last 30-ish years, has been where there is a series of meetings at each level of the national security bureaucracy, building up to and possibly including the President of the United States. They are often called the Principals Committee meetings, and below that, the Deputies Committee meetings, and below that, IPCs or working groups, depending on the level of the administration. They almost always rename it to make it sound new and unique. But that hasn't always been the case. There was not always a procedure like that. I think it was in the Bush 41 administration that the Principals Committee and deputies were institutionalized in their current form. That is up to the president. There is nothing in the Constitution that says how the president has to make national security decisions. If the president decides that he wants a chief strategist whispering in his ear, they're going to make policy that way, fine. Again, that's up to every 4 years the American people to decide if that's the way they want national security policy being made. You can have the most elaborate structure in the world of meetings, but if somebody else is whispering in his ear at the last minute, then that's going to be effective for that president. Now, I happen to think that there's a huge national security bureaucracy in this country for a reason. There's a whole lot of smart people who are involved in all of the national security departments. Getting their input on the policies at the working level, processing that through experienced officers and experienced others in the U.S. government to work up to those levels to make the toughest decisions. There's a reason for that, and it is not to draw out the process and to have endless meetings. Nobody likes that. It's because, generally, the best policies rise to the top through that process. All things being equal, there's a reason for that, and it does work, and intelligence informs every single one of those levels, up to and including the president. For Dwight Eisenhower, that worked. That fit his background. That was his style as a commander, to have that stately procession of briefings and meetings. For John F. Kennedy, he did not have that same experience. And he would make decisions in a much different way. Fascinating to look at the difference between that description of Eisenhower and the Cuban Missile Crisis discussions that were held with Kennedy. Amazing contrast between the two. Both often ended up with very good policy and very good results. Totally different style of the decision maker, drive the process beneath it. We don't yet know what's going to happen in this administration. They did release a memo saying who would be on the National Security Council's Principal Committee and deputies. A whole bunch was made of that. Who cares? I don't care whether somebody is formally sitting in the meeting. If that person is going to have the ear of the president before he makes a decision anyway, that is not the most important issue. It does have importance if it's going to influence other people and what they bring to the president, then it's an issue. But it really isn't the defining issue for how a decision is made.
Right, Hershey.
I think it, from all that you've talked about, is that the CIA is the producer of the president's favorite briefing.
Yeah.
And, you know, we have a lot of IAs in this country. We have the Defense Intelligence, the State Intelligence,
sure.
FBI. How does the daily brief take into consideration all of these other sources, and then how do you deal with the bias of a particular analyst?
Sure. Yeah, there is an evolution there. The question is, as the CIA, essentially, the CIA has owned the president's daily brief, how do they take into account opinions, assessments from experts in other agencies? The CIA did create the President's Daily Brief. The CIA officers wrote for it, edited it, produced it, disseminated it, briefed it for decades. That changed after September 11th. As part of the investigations into 9/11, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence was created. The PDB was moved to that bureaucracy. So now, the President's Daily Brief is an intelligence community product, no longer exclusively the purview of the CIA. But what folks told me who were involved in it, still largely a CIA product. The bulk of the analysts who work on it, the briefers, still run out of CIA headquarters. But people are seconded to the Directorate of National Intelligence when they're on that job. But what it does mean is that this document that once took into account the perhaps conflicting opinions and expertise of people within the CIA now has the conflicting expertise and opinions of people all over 16-plus intelligence agencies. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Well, all things equal, it's probably a good thing. You get more smart people on tough problems. Generally, that works out well historically. It can lead to a more cumbersome bureaucratic process of producing this document. It can lead people to seek to get that product out the door for tomorrow morning's daily briefing book. Oh, we just need to compromise because we can't really hammer this out in the time frame we have. That's a danger. But it's still good to have smart people giving opinions on these tough issues. There is some tension still between the intelligence agencies. But one thing the Director of National Intelligence, there have been several of them, but the one thing that the Office of the Director of National Intelligence has done well is trying to find a way to integrate those when it comes to producing this document for the President. In other areas, it's still an experiment that's playing out. Thank you.
Who makes the final decision as to what the content is?
Ultimately, that is the Director of National Intelligence. Most of the directors of national intelligence have delegated that responsibility to others because they have enough other things to manage. This has been a tension for every CIA director up until about 2004, and now for the Director of National Intelligence since 2004. How much time do we spend on the most important daily document going to the most important man in the world? Some people, like Porter Goss, the CIA director in the George W. Bush administration for a couple of years, he saw this as his primary responsibility. He said he spent about half of his working day in various points of the day working on this, preparing for it. He thought that was his job. And it was, among thousands of other things. Other directors have said, you know what, I'll read it in the morning as it goes to the president, but I don't want to be involved in it. Let the analysts do it. And they have not taken a hand there. There's strong arguments both ways, but it does have an opportunity cost. If you spend that much time as CIA director, spending, or now as DNI, focusing only on this one document, there's a whole lot of things you're not doing in the day. Thanks.
Yep. I think one more question. What happened? We got there. Sean, right?
I'd like to ask you a question. Is, you know, we have a room full of students here who maybe become future policymakers. Maybe one of us one day will read the PDB. Advising us through your historical and analytical career, how would you say, how can we be good consumers of the PDB and make sound policy out of it?
Yeah, to be a sound consumer of intelligence, it doesn't require, it's certainly much better if you realize the purpose of intelligence. Some people see intelligence, especially new policymakers coming into the national security positions from an outside business or industry, see intelligence as an answer machine, which is you throw in all of this collection from intercepted communications, from human sources, from diplomats overseas, from open press reporting, from satellite imagery, you put it in the machine, you turn the crank, and out pops the answer. That's not intelligence most of the time. Sometimes intelligence is so exquisite that it is. Sometimes you find out, yes, Mr. President, look at this picture. These are nuclear-capable missiles in Cuba. The Soviets said they're not going to do that. They're doing it. Sometimes it is an answer machine. Most of the time, you're dealing with things even the people involved in the decisions overseas don't know what they're going to do yet. How are the Syrians going to react if we do this? You don't turn the crank and get an answer to that, because the people making that very decision don't know. Is there going to be a coup in this country? We don't know. We don't even know who's going to throw the coup, much less if they're going to succeed. There's no answer machine that gives you that. So a good intelligence customer is somebody who realizes what intelligence can do and what it can't do. I'll give you the case of Bill Clinton, who was actually criticized by many as an intelligence customer because he didn't take daily briefings, he didn't interact with intelligence as much as his predecessor had done. Like I tell you, Bush 41 is a high bar to follow on that. But he told me that one day he was reading the president's daily brief and saw a map of Mogadishu. It's hard to remember now, but at the beginning of the Clinton administration, Somalia was one of the top topics. It was an absolute mess. And he said he was looking at this map of Mogadishu, and he remembered the day before that one of the warlords had control of this part of the city. But today he looked at the map, and the warlord had control of a much bigger part of the city. He thought, man, he must have had a hell of a night. And then he caught himself and realized, nope, that's the nature of intelligence. You don't get collection on a minute-by-minute basis. This isn't like Enemy of the State with Will Smith, with instantaneous intelligence collection going directly to somebody's monitor. Instead, it comes in fits and starts. As a policymaker, he learned to understand, okay, I may have to make a decision today, but the intelligence collection I need to inform that decision may not come to tomorrow. And he told me he had to decide on a regular basis, what do I have to decide on now, knowing that I don't have a complete picture? And what can I say, let's give it one more day? That level of nuance, that level of understanding of when do I have to make a choice is the kind of policymaker you want. Unfortunately, that largely comes through experience. And when you have a team come in that has almost no experience in national security decision making, it's very easy either to jump on a decision right away, absent the information needed to make that decision, or to simply wait and say, let's wait for more, let's wait for more, let's wait for more. And then the time of decision is passed and you've already been locked into another strategy. Thank you. And with that,